asset. What's the definition for asset? Because this is liability. Definition for assets. I tutorial it. Definition for asset in tutorial one, right? One or two lah. Yeah, okay. What's the definition? Resources control guarantee as a result of past event. Then, yeah, future economic benefit is expected to flow to an entity. That is for asset. Liability. Present obligation of the entity arising from past event. And the settlement which is expected to result in an outflow. So present obligation, we know there are legal obligation, constructive. Legal is like trade paper. Loan, all this, you must pay. You take the goods, you must pay. Loan, you take the loan, you must pay. Accrual, all these are legal obligation. Constructive obligation is due to your past practice, published policy, remember? Okay, so IS 37, tutorial 8 is on IS 37, liability. So we know trade paper is a liability. A loan, accrual, bank overdraft, provision is also a liability. IS 37 is on provision. The rest, all this, there is no definition for each and all this. However, we have a specific definition for provision. Okay, now? So, provision. IS 37 is on provision. Contingent liability, contingent assets. Provision means what? The definition here will be a liability of uncertain timing and amount. A liability on in which we do not know when is the timing of the payment and the amount. Okay, so provision is a liability of uncertain timing amount. Contingent liability will be here. Contingent asset here. Contingent liability, contingent assets are disclosure items. Provision, we recognize the liability in our book, SPL, SFP. Contingent liability, contingent asset, we don't recognize. We only disclose. Okay, now? We only disclose contingent asset liability if necessary. Okay, so we focus on provision first. Okay, provision account, this is how we record. Before, this is before we introduce IS 37. This is how we record. Wait, I would like to provide 1,000 provision here. Provision, provide 1,000 liability as a provision of 1,000. Then, from nothing become 1,000. SPL, how much is my income or expenses? From nothing liability, now I got a liability of 1,000. So there's an increase in liability. So 1,000, nothing. So the balancing is here, 1. So I charge to P&L expenses. Second year, I want to provide again. This time, I estimate my liability to be around 1,006. Income or expenses? Income or expenses? Expenses. How much? 600. Because it's 1,000 increased to 1,006. Increased by 1,006. Increased by 600. So you take 1,006. 1,000. The difference is 600 here. It is an expenses. Year 3. I would like to make a provision of 900. Income or expenses? Income. Why? It's a 1,006 liability. Now 900 liability reduced by 700. Otherwise, you can do it this way. 1,006, 900. There's a difference of 700. Balancing here. It's an income. Okay, no? So we can conclude one thing here. Provision accounts, when we maintain a provision account, it can be an expenses, it can also be income, depending on the increase or decrease. However, one thing for sure is provision is confirmed a liability, liability, liability. Cannot. It's a liability of uncertain timing and amount. Okay, not? So this is how we record a provision account. So before IAS 37 is introduced, company use provision accounts to manipulate their profit. Okay, not? They try to, the word that we use here, they try to smoothen the profit, means profit smoothing using provision account. How? Profit smoothing using provision account. So here, this one is my actual sales, actual cost, actual profit for the year. Okay? Then year two is my estimated sales cost gross of it. Estimated. Actual profit 3,000 this year. I estimate my profit next year to be 1. Okay? If my bonus is based on profit, then can you see that my bonus is going to reduce? And then my boss will look at me, hey, how come the profit reduced? Then they look at me one time, the performance has dropped. So I would like to manipulate my accounts to make my profit looks good, smoothen my profit using provision account. This is what they do last time. To smoothen profit, at the time when my profit is high, I bring it down. When it is low, estimated, when it's low, I would like to bring it up. So this year, considered higher than next year, estimated. So bring it down slightly. I would like to bring down by 1,006. Open a provision account. Create a provision of 1,006. So income or expenses? Expenses of 1,006 this year. So provision is an expenses this year, 1,006. So my profit reported will be 1,004. Okay. Next year, as expected, I budget 1 and actual also 1. 1,004, 1,000. Not good. I would like to increase my profit. Can I? Yes, I want to increase by, let's say, 700. I want to increase my profit by 7. How? Use provision. How much should I provide now? 9. So when I provide 900, 1,006 become 9. So the balancing is here, 7. Is an income. So provision now is an income. Decrease in provision, income. So profit reported now is 1,007. So I show an improved result. So my boss will be happy. Hopefully my bonus is higher. Can I smoothen my profit using provision account? This is what they do last time. Can I? So the problem here is the manipulation, and there is no consistency. Remember our tutorial 1 or 2 on a character, qualitative characteristic enhancing. We got VCAT. We look at a C, which is comparability, right? Okay, you see, company, they should not provide, and yet they go and provide. Company should provide, and yet they never provide. Can you see there is no consistency? Last time, company should make a provision, and yet they don't. Company shouldn't make a provision, and yet they go and provide. So there's no consistency. When you have consistency, you can have comparability. When there's no consistency, no comparability, no quality. Understand? So, because of that, IAS 37 is introduced. IAS 37, we want to make sure those that must provide. Those that have to provide, they must provide. Those that do not have to, they should not. Okay? So, when must the company provide? The IAS 37 come up with 3 conditions. These are the 3 conditions. Provision is a liability on uncertain timing and amount. Okay, a liability should be recognized when you have 1, 2, and 3. Okay, the keyword, there must be present obligation as a result of past event. It must be probable of economic outflow and reliable estimate. You can see on the board here.
This one is the previous part. This is the 1, 2, 3. Present, probable, reliable estimate.
Okay. When you meet the three conditions here, you must provide. You cannot say no. Understand? All three must be met. So we spend like 30 seconds memorize it. To recognize a provision in our book, there must be present obligation as a result of past event. It must be probable outflow. And the outflow here, because provision is more on estimation, therefore there must be a reliable estimate. Provision is an estimation, therefore it must be reliable, reliably measured. Okay, reliable estimate. So if you meet the three, you recognize a provision, a liability. Do you have to disclose after you recognize? No need. Provision, you either recognize or you don't. Okay. Now, the table first. So the three condition, present obligation, past event, probable of outflow, reliable estimate. If we meet the three, we recognize provision. So now we focus on the second one. Probable, here we are talking about probable outflow, means the likelihood of money out. Okay. Probable means more than 50%. The standard did not mention how many percent, but probable means more than 50% chance. Virtually certain means almost confirmed. Virtually assured, virtually certain, more than 90. We take it as more than 90. Possible, less than 50. Remote, less than 10% chance. Meaning, there's a 90% chance of becoming a liability. 90% chance there's a liability of asset. When it's more virtually certain, then what we do? We will therefore recognize the provision. There's a 90% chance of a liability. Very high chance of liability. Please recognize the liability. If there's a 50% chance, more than 50% chance of becoming a liability, means it's probable, we also recognize. If there's a less than 50% chance, then we don't recognize. What we do, we disclose in the notes. So we disclose as contingent liability. When there's a less than 10% chance of becoming a liability, so we no need to disclose. Don't even have to, don't recognize, don't even have to disclose, no action. This one will be further explained later, but you must know what to do when you have this likelihood here. L is liability, A is for assets. When we have a 90% chance of becoming an asset, we will recognize the asset. It's virtually certain, recognize asset. When it's more than 50% chance, we just have to disclose as contingent asset. Less than 50% chance of becoming an asset, no action, no action. Means do nothing, do nothing. No need to recognize, no need to disclose. Will be further explained later. So more than 50% recognize. Less depends. Disclose or no need to disclose. More than 50, more than let's say it's virtually certain, then only we recognize. Otherwise, at most we disclose. Okay? So this one is more on the second point here. Bullet point number two. Bullet point number two says it must be probable. Means must be more than 50% chance. Okay. So example. So three main example on liability here. This is on warranty. three bullet points here: present obligation, probable outflow, reliable estimate. I sell 1,000 television. 5% of it, I sell 1,000 television. I give a 1 year warranty. 1 year warranty. And of course, not all will be returned, correct? I sell 1,000, 1,000 return, then it's a problem with the product. I didn't know. I sell 1,000. I, based on my experience, I think 5% will be returned for repair and replace. Not sure. So 5% of the 1,000 will be 50 television. So is this estimated? Repair next year. I expect 50 to be returned for repair and replace. Estimated. And this 50 here is based on my estimation. I quite confirm that they will be returned. Virtually certain. Virtually certain. So virtually certain of returning. And some return are due to remote control, repair or remote control. Some due to the button, some due to the screen. So can be many types. So I estimate the repair cost to be around 200. Again, estimation. So 5%, 50 is estimation, 200 is estimation. So if they return, I have to repair, it's going to cost me 10,000. Have I paid? Haven't. Is I estimate next year, if they return, I have to pay. So should I provide when I close my accounts here? Provision. I sell television, I estimate 5, in estimated cost 10,000. Should I make a provision here? So provision, I must meet three conditions. What are the three? There must be present obligation as a result of past event. Do I have obligation to repair the TV if they return? Yes. Why? Because I give them the warranty. I have the present obligation. It's a legal obligation. Is it probable that they were, is it probable outflow will be required at 10,000? Is it probable? Yeah, not this 5%. This 5% is the one I estimate will be returned. And this one will be considered probable. Will be returned? Yes. Can I estimate the cost reliably? There. 10. So, provide. So I'm going to recognize 10,000 expenses, 10,000 liability in year one. Okay? Haven't paid, that's why it's a liability. Second year, I sold zero TV. No more liability in year end. Okay? And then in the second year, about 42 television were returned. And it cost me a repair cost of 9,002 next year. So must I pay? Yeah, I have to bank. I credit my bank. Where do I debit? Debit repair or debit provision? So I debit my provision. Okay, I have already provided 10,000 for the repair last year. So this year I incur 9,002. I credit my bank. I debit 9,002 here. I have provided 10. But pay only 9,200. And I don't sell any more TV, so no more liability at the end. So what do I do with this 8? I provided 10, but actually incur only 9,200. So it's an over provision charged to SPL income. Is it okay? What if okay, I provide year 1, 10. In the year one, I charge SPL 10. Do I know exactly when I'm going to pay the 10,000? When they're going to repair, send back for repair? I'm not sure when they're going to repair. Do I know how much is the cost I'm going to incur? No. So it's a liability. 10,000 here is a liability of uncertain timing and amount. So, and next year, scenario two, I incur 10,600 to repair. So I credit my bank. I debit here. So provide 10, but incur 10,600. under provision. Therefore, I charge to SPR. 600 is an expenses, additional expenses. Understand? So, is it very normal to have over under provision every year? Very normal, because the 10,000 is an estimation. Okay, it's an amount, it's a liability of uncertain timing and amount. Okay, I continue with this example. I wrap up this. Now, if I continue to sell television in the second year, last time I sell 1,000, in second year I sell more television. Do you think my liability will be more provision? So I'm going to provide even more. NUN. During the year, I have repair cost 9,002. So credit bank, debit, repair, not provision. End of the year, I sell more television, meaning my liability will be even more, 20. Bring up. So how much should I charge to P&L? 20,920, 19,2. Because I sell more, I provide more. Automatically adjust, no worry. Is it okay? Can I? So this is provision for warranty. Next example. Okay, this example is on legal case. Just now it's warranty. Now legal case. Okay, example two. Someone sue me for 10,000 because of food poisoning. And we know legal case normally take a few years or take some time. So let's say it take a few years. And at year end, I ask my lawyer, what is the chances of me losing the case? The lawyer says 98% chance of losing the case. Is it virtually certain? Virtually certain of losing. Confirm, more or less confirm losing. Should I make a provision for this 10,000? Three bullet points. First one, is there a present obligation? Yeah, they sue me. If I lose, I will have to pay the 10. There is an obligation for me to pay. Okay, not? Why? Because of the food poisoning, the past event. What's the second bullet point? Probable outflow. Is it probable 98%? Yeah, it's virtually certain. More than probable. Yes. Can the obligation be estimated reliably? Yeah, they sue me for 10,000. Yeah. So should I provide? Yes, I should make a provision. Understand? 10,000. How? Open a T account, provision, like what you did just now here. Make a provision, 10,000, bring up P&L, that's it. Second scenario, someone sue me for 10. I ask my lawyer, lawyer say 60% chance of losing, have to pay. If I lose, 60% chance of losing, should I provide? First, is there a present obligation? Yeah, they sue me as a result of past event. Is it probable? 60%? Yes. Can I estimate reliably? Yes, provide. Third example, this one later. So this is provision. Example three is when you are the guarantor. Example one, warranty. Example two is on the legal case. Example three, what if you are the guarantor? You are the company, you. This is another company. It's a new company without track record. No assets, no income, nothing, new. If this company here go to the bank and they borrow 1 million, do you think the bank will lend the money? No. No track record, no assets to back up, nothing. So what happened is you have a lot of assets, your company make a lot of profit, you come in here and you become a guarantor of this amount. You know what's a guarantor? You guarantee this 1 million. In the event that this company cannot pay, you have to come in and have to pay the 1 million. You are the guarantor. Just like next time you buy a car, you will have a boat. Now you don't buy a car, your parents is your guarantor. Cannot? So now, you sign an agreement to become a guarantor. Immediately, you have an obligation to pay the 1 million. If they can't pay, you have the obligation. Legal or constructive? You sign the agreement, it means legal. So now, the company is not doing very well, very bad. Making losses, no money to pay the bank for 2 installments. First question, first bullet point, is there an obligation? Yes, legal obligation as a result of past event. The event is you become a guarantor. Is it probable that you have to pay for this 1 million? Yeah, they are not doing well. Now it's probable. Can it be reliably estimated? Yes, 1 million. What must you do in your book? Make a provision. How much? 1 million. Understand? So, provision, if you meet the 3, please recognize. Okay? Okay, now. Definition for provision, a liability of uncertain timing and amount, done. Contingent liability, contingent asset is more on disclosure. This is contingent liability. This is contingent asset. So contingent liability, we have 2 bullet points. Second bullet point, we got another 2 sub points. Understand? So it's a possible obligation. And second bullet point, there is a present obligation. But we don't recognize because it's not probable and it's not measured reliably. What is this example? This is contingent liability. Yeah? Okay, remember this table. Liability, probable or above, we recognize. Otherwise, we disclose. Okay? Okay, this example. Someone sue me for 10. I asked my lawyer. Lawyer says, this case actually is a non-issue. We have all the evidence. However, the chances of winning is 70% winning. 30% chance losing. So, should I provide 10,000? Next. The first thing, is there a present obligation? Yeah, already sue me. I have a present obligation. Yes. Can I measure them? Is it probable? 30%? No, it's not probable. That outflow will be required. Can I reliably estimate? Yes. Should I provide? No. So, no provision. What must I do? Disclose as contingent liability. So, contingent liability, you either disclose or you don't disclose. Understand? So, liability. Provision is a liability. Contingent liability is not a liability. We only disclose contingent liability if it's necessary. Okay, next one. 5% chance of losing. There's a present obligation. It's not probable. Can I reliably estimate? Yes. What do I do? Do I provide? No. Do I disclose? So, no action or do nothing. Understand? Is there a contingent liability? They sue me for 10. There is a contingent liability. But do I have to disclose? 5% chance of losing, 95% chance of winning. I'm going to win the case. No need to disclose. No, don't recognize. Don't even have to disclose. Okay? 5%. Remote. Next. Someone sue me for 10. Lawyer says 60% chance of losing. But this lawyer go on and mention, this judge is very, very, very unpredictable. Sometimes they sue me 10. If I lose, they will award damages more than 10. Can be 20, can be 30, can be 40. And can be zero. Or 1,000. So, is there a present obligation? Yes. Is it probable? 60%? Yes. Can it be reliably estimated? No. Do I provide? No. Therefore, disclose as contingent liability. Okay, no? So we have scenario one, scenario two. You look at scenario one in blue. There is a present obligation, but not probable. Understand? Scenario two, there is a present obligation, but cannot be reliably estimated. That is why we don't recognize, we only disclose as contingent. So contingent liability is, there is a present obligation in blue, however, cannot be reliably estimated. Sorry, number two, this one cannot be reliably estimated, or it is not probable. Okay, let's look at the definition. Scenario one and two. Contingent liability, we look at this one. There is a present obligation, already sue me, the one in blue. But we don't recognize as liability or provision. Why? Because, first one, it is not probable, scenario one. Or there is a present obligation, we don't recognize as liability because it cannot be measured reliably, scenario two. Is it okay? And first bullet point, possible obligation here means I sell the goods, my customer, they have food poisoning. I know it's my problem, but they haven't sued me. So no present obligation, but I think they're going to sue me. So it's a possible obligation. So this is also contingent liability. So contingent liability, first bullet point, is a possible obligation. I think they're going to sue me. So I may want to disclose. Second bullet point here, already sue me, but I don't recognize as liability because it's not probable. I don't recognize liability because it's what? Cannot be measured in liability. Is it okay? And now, contingent asset. Or before contingent, one more example here. I'm a guarantor for this company here, and they are doing quite okay. Every year, they will make payment. So, how? Do I have present obligation? Yes, the day when I sign to become a guarantor, I have present obligation. Is it probable? They are doing very, very well, and they make payment. Is it probable? It is not probable. Can I estimate them reliably? Yeah, as they pay, the amount here can be estimated reliably. So do I make a provision on the 1 million? No need. So do I disclose this contingent liability? Yes, I will disclose. Understand? Don't recognize, but you can disclose this contingent liability. Got it? Now, contingent assets. I terbalik now. I sue other people for 10,000. I ask my lawyer. Lawyer says, yeah, 98% chance of winning. If I win, I'm going to take the 10,000, correct? Not? So 98% chance of winning, not now, but in the future. So what should I do now? It's virtually certain I'm going to win. What's the treatment? I recognize asset. Okay, now recognize the income, recognize the asset, receivable. Haven't received the money yet. But what if our lawyer says, yeah, we have a very high chance of winning, about 60% chance. It is probable that we're going to win. How? We're going to disclose as, we're going to disclose in the notes as contingent asset. 30% chance of winning. I sue someone and they say it's 30% chance of winning only. Don't recognize, don't disclose. 10% chance of winning. Same thing. Cannot. This is contingent asset. Now, here. I sue someone for 10, winning chance is 30%. Is there a contingent liability? I said, yes. Just that I don't have to disclose. When I sue someone, I have a contingent asset. I disclose if it's 60%. 98% chance of winning. Do I have a contingent asset? No. Why? Because I already recognize asset. So when I recognize asset, means no contingent asset. Already recognized. Is already an asset, it's not a contingent asset. Is it okay? Okay. So, we can, let's summarize the whole thing. We have a definition for provision. We have definition for contingent asset, contingent liability. Before IAS 37 is introduced, they used the provision account to manipulate the account. Profit smoothing. Remember? Profit smoothing. Listen. Therefore, IAS 37 is introduced. And they say IAS 37, to recognize, you must meet the three conditions. Then you recognize. If you do not meet, then you may have to disclose as contingent liability. Got it? Okay. Question 1. Tutorial 8. Provision, contingent liability, contingent asset. A. Define provision, a liability of uncertain timing and amount. Contingent liability, 2 bullet points, possible obligation. The other one is present obligation, but we don't recognize asset liability because it is not probable or cannot be measured reliably. Contingent asset, you refer. So I give B. When should we recognize provision? When should provision should be recognized? When? 3 bullet points. Present obligation, past event, probable outflow, measure reliably the cost. So, done. I give you the answer. Provision is a liability of uncertain timing and amount. Possible obligation, present obligation. When you copy, next week when I check, this one you make it into 2 bullet points and the second bullet point 2 sub bullet points. Okay, now like this. Contingent liability 2 bullet points and then the second bullet point 2 sub. So do this here. Possible, present, you don't recognize because it's not probable, because it's not what measured reliably. Okay, where is it stated? Because it's not probable, the one in box. There is a present, but not recognized because it's not probable. Or, cannot be measured reliably. Get it? Contingent asset is a possible, this is a definition, is a possible asset. Okay, means most likely we're going to win. But possible asset, we don't disclose. Only when it's highly high chance we only recognize the contingent element. Provision, three bullet points that contingent liability should not be recognized. Yes. If it's recognized, we don't call it contingent liability. If it's recognized, we call it a liability. Okay? Contingent liability should not be recognized. Yeah, at most we disclose. If we recognize, we call it a liability. Got it? Contingent asset should not be recognized, because if we recognize, then it is an asset. We don't recognize, then it's a contingent. Next question is, do we disclose? If it's probable, then we disclose. Understand? If it's possible, we don't do anything. Question part C. After annual dinner, in year 16, 10 people suffered from food poisoning. Legal proceedings started, means they have already sued us, but we don't agree, we take it as not our liability, we dispute the liability. Up to the date of approval for the year end 31st October, lawyer of the restaurant advises that it is probable that it will not be found liable, meaning it is probable that we will not lose the case. It is probable that we will not be liable. So, do we recognize provision? Your four marks, first mentioned, is there a present obligation as a result of past event? Yes. The present obligation, because they sue us, due to the past event is the selling of the food, as a result there's a food poisoning, past event. Is it probable? Outflow of resources will be required. Is it probable I have to pay? Read nicely, it is probable I will not be found liable. Means, is it probable I will have to pay? It is not probable. Understand? So, what do I do? Do I recognize? So, no provision should be recognized. Another mark. So, you see how I answer? The answer also like that, okay? Mention there's present obligation, past event is a food poisoning. One mark. It is not probable transfer economic benefit will be required. Not probable transfer economic benefit will be required. So, what's the conclusion? No provision. Then, we disclose as contingent liability unless the probability is considered to be remote, then no need to disclose. Repeat. Not recognized, but we disclose in the notes unless the outflow is remote, then don't do anything. Understand? Okay, the previous class we wrote there, so I use it here. Okay? No recognition or provision. Don't recognize. We disclose unless the probability is remote. Then we don't disclose. I give you the answer. We continue the second one. In year 2017, 1 year later, lawyer advised that owing to the development in the case, it is now probable that I will be found liable. 3 marks. How? How to answer? Huh? There is a present obligation as a result of the past event, which is the food poisoning. It is now probable transfer of economic benefit will be required. So, what's my conclusion? A provision therefore should be required. How much? If no mention of the value, a provision should be recognized to the best estimate. Best estimate. Cannot? If they give us, they sue us for 10,000, then you answer, a provision of 10,000 should be recognized. But now no figure is mentioned. So a provision should recognize to the best estimate. Got it? I'll give you the answer now. Part C. I change. On the basis of the evidence available, there will, when the financial statement is approved, there is a present obligation as a result of past event. What's the event? Food poisoning. However, I continue, however, it is not probable that transfer of economic benefit is required because the lawyer says so. So what's my conclusion? No provision is recognized. Do we disclose? Yes. The matter is disclosed as contingent liability unless the probability of the transfer economic benefit is regarded as remote. Then if it's very remote, very little chance, then no need to disclose. Okay. Second year, due to some development, now we got more evidence, they say we're going to lose. There is a present obligation as a result of past event, which is a food poisoning. It is now probable that transfer of economic benefit will be required. It is now probable. So what must I do? A provision is recognized. How much? For the best estimate of the amount needed to record, to settle the obligation. Cannot? Done. Number two. Okay, we have a new concept for number two. Which of the following circumstances might a provision be recognized? We have A, B, C, D. Look at A first, A and B together. On 13th of December 2016, the board of director decided to close down a division. Director decided to close down. They want to downsize the business. They want to relocate from Sabah to KL. They want to close down, relocate. They want to merge business, whatever. All these are considered called restructuring. They want to downsize, close down, transfer, relocate. All these are called restructuring. Okay, of the business. So when you restructure, you're going to cost you a lot of money. Alright? So mainly this question is on obligation. Is there an obligation or not? So the director decided to close down the division. The accounting year end is 31st December. Before 31st December, the decision was not communicated to any of those affected and no other steps were taken to implement the decision. So this is my timeline. Year end is here. The decision by director is on the 13th of December to close down the division. How many person are there in the boardroom to make the decision to close down? Example, about 6, 7, 8, 9 person. So there are 9 directors sitting in the room decided to close down a division. So the key point here, do the company have obligation to close down the division? They have decided to close down. In the boardroom, they make a decision, 9 of them, assuming 9 of them. Do they now have the obligation to close down? Do they have the obligation, must close down the division? Answer is no. So the standard did mention, director's decision to close down do not constitute an obligation. Why no? Because today they can decide to close down. Tomorrow they can have another meeting not to close down. So there's no obligation to close down. Understand? So no obligation means no liability. Okay? Then the standard go on mention. When does it constitute an obligation to close down? They give two points. Yeah. There is only obligation to close down a division, restructuring cost, when there's a detailed formal plan to close down. Detailed formal plan to close down. There's a plan to close down. Meaning, when I'm going to close down, next year, January. Who is going to be affected? My employee. What I'm going to do with the employee, I'm going to compensate them with salary 2 months. Supplier, I'm going to inform them, I have a plan to close down. What happened to those assets? I'm going to sell it. Can you see there's a plan to close down? And secondly, the closure and the plan is communicated to the affected party. Employee is affected, supplier is affected, customer is affected. They have been informed about the closure. So if I ask you, I have a plan to close down, and the plan has been communicated to the employee, has been communicated to the staff, communicated to supplier, communicated to the customer. Do I now have obligation to close down? Yes, I have a constructive obligation. Due to my action, because of an expectation, I now have a constructive obligation. Got it? So director's decision is not an obligation, but when you have a detailed formal plan, when it's communicated to the affected party, whereby they have the expectation that I'll close down, yes, there is an obligation. We call this constructive. Got it? So now let's read over this one again. The board of director decided to close down. Sorry, no obligation. It is not communicated to any of those affected, and no other steps were taken to implement the decision. Do the company have any obligation to close down? No. Therefore, no provision. You haven't done anything yet? No obligation. Understand? B. The board has agreed to a detailed closure plan. They have agreed to the plan to close down on the 20th December. And the details were given to the customer, were also given to the employee, meaning they were communicated to these people here, affected by it. Do the company now have obligation? Yes, it's a constructive obligation. So A, we don't recognize, no provision. B, yes, we have an obligation, we must recognize. C, the company is obliged to incur cleanup costs. You have the responsibility to incur a cleanup cost on the environmental damage, which you have already caused. What is your decision? Provision? Why? Is there a present obligation? Yes. Is it probable? Yeah, you already caused, you must incur. In fact, it's virtually certain. Can you reliably estimate? Yeah, you make a provision on the best estimate. Got it? Number D. The company intends to carry out future expenditure. Future cost, future expenditure. Do we recognize now? If I tell you next year, now is December, I want to employ next year, future, 2 employees, it's going to cost me 20,000 next year. Do I recognize provide now? Yes, no? Do I have obligation? I have intention to hire 2. Do I have the obligation now to hire 2? No obligation. I can decide not to hire. I can decide to hire 1. There's no obligation on my part to hire that 2. So, no obligation, no need to provide. Cannot? So, answer for number 2. Board of Directors minute, our Board of Directors decision, and it has not been communicated, no provision. There is a constructive obligation because it's communicated, detailed formal plan, yes. Number C, I already caused damage, yes, make a provision. Last one, no provision, no obligation because it's not an obligation to whether to hire, to incur the expenses. Future expenses is not an obligation. Okay, I can avoid making the payment or incur the cost. Number three. During the year, the company give a guarantee. Just now we have a food poisoning legal case. Now your company give a guarantee of a certain borrowing of Pandai, whose financial statement or condition at the time is considered sound. Sound means good or not good? The financial statement is considered sound. Good, huh? Unsound mind means good or not good? You have an unsound mind. Unsound, like you. Unsound? No good. Sound means good. So sound company is sound means good. So that is 2016. 2017, the company deteriorates, means not good. And the file for protection from creditor. So 2016, the company Pandai, you are the guarantor. And they are doing very well. What do you do? 4 marks. Answer. Is there a present obligation as a result of past event? Yes, the event is you become a guarantor. Is it probable transfer of economic benefit will be required? It is not probable. Therefore, no provision is to be recognized. Is it okay? Continue. What else? It should be disclosed as contingent liability unless the probability is considered to be remote, then no need to disclose. Understand? So there is a present because of the guarantee. No, not probable that transfer economic benefit will be required. Hence, no provision should be recognized. A disclosure will be required unless the probability is considered to be remote. Second year deteriorates and now they have filed protection, means they are not doing well, and you are the guarantor. How? There is a present obligation because of the guarantee, because you have become a guarantor. It is now probable that future economic benefit will be transferred. Outflow will be required. So what's your decision? Yes, a provision should be recognized. How much? How much? Best estimate. Okay. Best estimate. Answer. This one taken already. So your answer must be in full. There is a present because of past event. The event is becoming a guarantor. So, however, no transfer economic benefit is required. Therefore, no provision. If no provision, we will disclose unless the probability is remote. Then no need to disclose. Second year, again, there's a present obligation because of giving the guarantor. It is now probable. Therefore, we must make a provision. How much? Best estimate. Okay, almost similar one. Yeah. Number four. Wata give warranty. So we have a legal case, the food poisoning, just now guarantee, and now the warranty. Under the term, the warranty of the manufacturer undertake to make good means to repair or to replace manufacturing defects that become apparent within 3 years. Sell today, give 3 years warranty. Example, car. Should provision be recognized? Yes, because there's a present obligation. Yeah, past event, it is probable. We must based on best estimate. So the answer, okay, you see, Wata, because you give warranty, you cannot avoid paying the cost for repair or replacement. You cannot avoid, means it's your obligation. okay, due to the warranty given, therefore the conclusion is a provision should therefore be made. So this paragraph here tells us that a provision should be made. This paragraph you can skip. That's why I put a background. I box it and put a cross here. These two bullet points is to tell you how much. Here, first paragraph is to tell you what is the conclusion. Yes, we must provide. And you go and I explain how much to provide. This is my example. I sell 100 television. Year end is here. I sell 100 television. One is already returned to me before the year end. I haven't repaired. But I estimate repair cost to be 500. Haven't repaired, but I estimate 5. And then at this year end, I sell 100 television. I estimate another 5 may be returned. And it's going to cost me another 8. So how much should I provide at year end? Those that has been written but haven't repaired, 5, plus those I estimate may return. So the total I'm going to provide will be 1003. Okay, so this is bullet point 1, this is bullet point 2 here. May point 1 plus point 2. Let's go through here. First paragraph mentioned we have to provide how much? First bullet point, the cost of making goods the item for which defect have been notified. The 500 already notified before the year. But haven't repaired. Plus, estimated cost in respect of those items sold. This is an estimated cost. So 500 already notified but not yet repaired. Plus those estimated costs that is I expect to repair. So it's actually bullet point 1 plus bullet point 2. Understand? One is before, one is expect future. Done. Number 5. Pelangi minuman, manufacture and sell, customer of his drinks, fell ill after consuming for a long period. He needed medical attention and had to postpone his studies. He sued us for $750 for the pain and agony caused by consuming the drinks and postponing the studies. He sued us for $750. Pelangi made a provision for liability of $150. So we provided $150 already. They sued us $750, we provide $150. The court case was pending at year end, a month after the year end, but before the financial statement is authorized. After year end, before authorized. The case came to the court and judgment was that in favor of our customer, means we lose the case. He was awarded $600,000. So during the year, sue me $750. End of the year, I estimate my liability to be $150. Therefore, I provide. After the year end, but before it was authorized for issue, legal case happened or the result has been announced that I lose the case. So, which IS are we bringing in now? IS 10. Correct? Because it happened between the year end and also the financial statement is authorized by you. IS 10. So, yeah, it happened within this period. We have to decide. Adjusting or non-adjusting? Huh? Adjusting. Why? Because it provides evidence that the condition already exists at the end of the reporting. The liability already exists. So, must I go back and adjust my liability? How much must I adjust? How much must I adjust? No, how much must I adjust additional? I must additional provide additional $450 because I have already provided $150 as liability. My actual liability is $600. So provide additional $450. Got it? So this one got two standards. IS 10, because happened after, so we must go back and adjust. When we go back and adjust, we adjust using, we apply IS 37. How much should I provide based on the best estimate? In this case, I already know the amount, 600. Therefore, provide full, 600. So number five, you have taken already, I just now together with number four. This is an adjusting event because they are exist at the end of the reporting period. So the adjustment will be additional loss with a corresponding liability should be recognized. Additional liability of 450 should be recognized. Got it? Number six. Abacus has profit sharing plan to pay its employee 5% of profit before tax if they exceed 6 million. Company agreed to pay 5% bonus share, every one share, if the company make more than 6. Then when I complete the financial statement, the profit is 690. So do I have the obligation now to pay the commission, the bonus? Yes. So please recognize another how much? 5 times 690. Make a provision another 34.5. So go back and adjust for another for 34.5. So amount charged to SPL 34.5. Expenses, liability. Got it? That's all. Number seven. Sanjong. Yeah, class and mapan. And two. No, 2:30. Our class and 2:30. Number seven. Sanjong's current financial year end is 31st December. Year end. 16 February, means after the year end, the director agreed to sell subsidiary Colama for consideration of fine. You sell it for 5 million after year end. The director authorized only in April. So your year end is December here. You authorize here. When you sell? February here. So apply IS 10. It falls within the period prescribed by IS 10, which is after the reporting before the financial statement is issued. So yeah, it happened within the period. Therefore, adjusting or not adjusting. You sell, you buy company, you sell company, flood, all these are non-adjusting events. Why? Because they provide condition that they exist, indicative condition that they exist, or no, they arose after reporting. So do I disclose? Yeah, if it's 5 million is considered to be material, then we should disclose this in our financial statement. Okay, non-adjusting. So this one got nothing to do with IS 37 provision. Nothing to do with provision. Nah, answer. The event occur between the 2 days. So we mentioned IS 10 occur between the 2 days. And because it's indicative of condition that arose after, therefore it's a non-adjusting event. So if it's a non-adjusting, with the following notes will be required, means we disclose. Number eight, last one. Buy asset, sell asset, buy subsidy, sell subsidy, all these are non-adjusting. You can't say that they already existed. No, you haven't existed. You only sell after. Number eight, last one. Year end of Usaha Jaya, the director of Usaha Jaya are reviewing the company's financial year end 30th June. The following material item has occurred, matters has occurred after reporting, but before it was authorized. Means all this happened between the 2 days. Okay, They say all the material matters occur between the two dates. One of the company's building was revalued during the year. The director are not sure as to the accounting treatment for revaluation surplus in the financial statement. You revalue during the year and you're not sure about the treatment. The surplus has been separately disclosed as item in the SPR. Okay, this is on PPE. What's the definition for PPE? Tutorial 1 and 2. A resources controlled by the entity, past event, and what? Future economic benefit is expected to flow to the entity, right? So that is for PPE. What's the definition? That is an asset. What's the definition for PPE? Sorry. Tangible asset. Held for what? By the entity for what? Production and supply and goods and services. For rental. And administrative or maintenance purpose. And? Yeah, more than 1 year. How many models? Cost model. What is cost model? Cost model and revaluation. We have cost less accumulated depreciation, less accumulated impairment. Revaluation model is revalue amount less accumulated, less accumulated. Revaluation up, go where? If down, reversal. Any excess, go to P&L. Okay, now? So what happened here? There's a revaluation during the year. And what is the treatment? They go and disclose it in the notes. Disclose it in the P&L. Correct or wrong? Wrong. Go back and adjust. Okay, there's an error here that you discover. So you must adjust the error. And what happened? You must record the revaluation in your revaluation reserves. Unless it's a reversal of revaluation deficit, then you go to P&L. Okay, revalue up, go to RR. Unless it's a reversal, then you go to P&L. I give you the answer for number 8. The revaluation is not disclosed in the P&L, but is credited to the revaluation reserves. Increase your RR in your equity, unless the revalue up is to reversal or revaluation deficit, then we recognize in the P&L. Okay? Number 2. Usaha guaranteed a loan of another company in 2015. We are now in 2017. You start guaranteeing last 2 years. No disclosure has been made in the previous financial statement. But the latter part of the year ended 30th June, meaning towards end of this year, the director suggested that it is now probable that liability will now fall upon us. It is now probable liability will fall upon us. We are a guarantor. So how? Is there a present obligation? What is the obligation here? What's the past event? The obligation we have to pay because we become a guarantor. Is it probable now? Transfer economic benefit will be required? Yes. Therefore, a provision should be recognized. How much? Yeah, best estimate because we do not know how much yet. Answer. It should be provided as soon as it becomes probable. And the provision should be made to the best estimate of the losses that will arise. Okay, best estimate. Next. 3. One of the company's director was dismissed during the beginning of the year as he had disclosed some confidential information to one of the competitors. The Usaha Jaya has commenced a legal action against this director, and the company has been advised that it is now probable that substantial damages will be awarded to the company. What is our answer, treatment? Huh? Others? Answer? Yes. How? provision. Why? Huh? Present obligation. Blah, blah, blah. 0 mark. Others? We have answer here correctly. So, this one here, who sue who? We sue other people. If they sue us, then yeah, we will have to provide because it's probable. Now I'm suing other people. And what is the chances of me winning? It is probable that we're going to win. So do I recognize as asset? I sue someone, it is probable I'm going to win. It is probable I'm going to win. I disclose this as my contingent asset. Okay, now don't recognize as your asset. If you recognize, means no longer contingent. So answer is, we should recognize this as your contingent. No, we should disclose this as contingent asset. We don't recognize, we disclose. Okay. This constitutes a probable contingent asset under IS 37. Because we are suing others, thus should be disclosed in the notes explaining the nature of the contingent asset. Why is the contingent? Because we sue other people due to whatever reason. And if it's not possible, and if possible, estimate the financial effect, the amount. Okay? Last one, very easy, is damaged by flood. And as a result, we make losses. Insurance company cover only part of the losses. We did before last week. We lost about 16 million. Insurance coverage is only 9 million. Do we? The company's going concern is not affected. Adjusting or not adjusting? Because they arose after. So how do we disclose? We will disclose in the notes separately the losses as well as the insurance coverage. Separately. Is it okay? Done. Answer taken. That's it. Okay, like earlier class, I start with tutorial 9 now. Tutorial 8, etc. Provision, definition, contingent liability, contingent asset. When do we recognize? If we don't recognize, do we disclose? That's it. Profit smoothing. Remember, before IS 37 is introduced, they use it to manipulate the profit. That's why they come up with a new standard to standardize consistency. Done. Okay, like early class, I start with a little bit on IS 12, which is relevant to IS tutorial 9. A quick one only, 10 minutes only, 10 to 15. Okay, IS 12 income tax, I can tell you, is not an easy standard. Degree, you will see this. If you intend to pursue further ACCA, you will see this, ICAW saying all this is very complicated standard. Even when you work your financial statement, okay, confirm you have deferred tax. Okay, not? So, I worked for this company as an auditor. When we try to finalize, everything has been done. Normally we start with one thing. We do not know how to calculate income deferred tax. So, because it's not easy. Okay, so later next week, you find it difficult, it's very normal. Okay, not? So, IS 12 income tax is current tax plus or minus deferred tax. Current tax is your profit, you must pay tax. So, it's between you and the government. You make more profit, you must pay more tax, current tax. Deferred tax is about deferred future, deferred tax. Future tax. Understand? So current and future. So we're going to recognize now. So you're going to plus or minus. So current tax will be current year tax provision, CYP, current year provision. If we make more profit, please provide more. And then you have to plus any prior year under provision. Last year, if you have under provided, you plus into this year. It can also be current year provision. You minus over provision from last year, prior year. Is it okay? So is that easy? Current year plus or minus over under provision. Deferred tax. You can have deferred tax asset, DTA. You can have deferred tax liability, DTL. So why do you have a DTA, deferred tax asset? Because you have a DTD, deductible temporary difference. Temporary difference. We have accounting profit. We have taxable profit. You learned last time, if I make 1,000 profit, does my tax 20% based on the accounting profit? Or must I adjust first to get my chargeable income? My profit is before profit, before tax is 1. Do we adjust first to calculate? Yeah, we have to adjust for capital allowance. Do we have to add depreciation? Add depreciation, add non-deductible expenses, and then we less capital allowance to get our chargeable income. So accounting profit and taxable profit is different. So when it comes to tax, we may have temporary difference. Okay, not? We may have temporary difference because accounting and taxable profit is different. Therefore, we may have a deductible temporary difference. Means deductible temporary difference before tax here means it is deductible in the future. If it's deductible in the future, good or bad? Good. Why? Because if it's deductible in the future, means deductible means profit will be lower, pay lower tax. So if it's deductible in the future, so I will recognize deferred tax asset now. Good. Because it's deductible, future, it is something good to me because it's deductible. What do I do now? I recognize asset now. Okay, now? If it's taxable in the future, means I have to pay tax in the future. Taxable, taxable, taxable in the future, means I have to pay tax in the future. What do I do now? I recognize liability now. So it's about future tax. What do I do now? I recognize the asset. I may recognize the liability now. Understand? So DTD, what is important for next week? You must know DTD will give rise to DTA. DTD give rise to DTA. Deductible means deferred tax asset now. Taxable temporary difference in the future. Taxable temporary DTD will give rise to DTL now. Okay, so we focus on current. This one we keep it everything for next week. Current tax. Okay, before I start, SPL, we learned before sales cost, gross, expense, PBT, tax. Last time in your book, you only recognize current tax. And it's normally given a current year provision for tax is 200,000. You just plug in that 20,000, 200 lah. But this time, you must take your current tax. You must also plus and minus different tax. How to get your current tax? Is your current year provision plus or minus over under provision, correct? Then different tax next week. So current year provision, I use this example. Next week I rub, then I redo one more time. Okay, my first year operation, I close my accounts here. AGM will be here. We learned before AGM annual general meeting. My financial statement must be signed here. IS 10 will cover this period. So AGM is when all the shareholders come in and we discuss on the financial statement. Means the financial statement will be discussed here. Once it is discussed, everything is finalized. The financial statement will be sent to the audit, sent to the tax agent. The tax agent will then calculate the tax to be paid by you. Is after AGM. After AGM. So meaning the actual tax will only be known after the AGM. It's normal. I mean, it's always like that. So when I close my accounts here, I make a profit. Must I make a provision for tax? I make profit, I will have a liability to pay tax. So I will estimate. Current year provision 100. So I make a provision 100. Understand? So since this is my first year, there is no over under provision from last year. So I'm going to charge SPL 100, done. Now we focus on second year. After the AGM, my actual tax is 120. How much I actually provided last year? I provide 100. My actual is 120. Can I go back and adjust last year's figure? Cannot. Why? AGM already over. Financial statement, everything adopted already. And it's outside the period. Nothing to adjust. Nothing to do with adjusting or adjusting. So you can't do anything with last year's figure. So the only thing you can do is the $20 here. You adjust in second year. So end of the year, in second year, I make profit. I will therefore make a provision on my profit. How much I provide this year? 250. Must I also adjust for last year? Yeah, last year provide 100. Actually is 12. I have under provided 20. I adjust under provision plus. So amount charged to SPL is current year plus under provision, 270. So this 270 will appear here. 250 plus 20. So my current year provision is 270. Understand? And deferred tax, we haven't learned. Continue second, third year. Forget about deferred tax first. Third year, same thing. My actual tax is 240. I provide 250. Actual tax is 240. End of the year, I make some more profit, even more. I make even more provision. Current year, year three. I adjust for last year provision. I provided 250, actual 40. Therefore, I have over provided by 10. Over provision 10, you minus. So 390. Is it okay? So this is for current, very easy. The problem is always deferred tax. So lastly, DTD, deductible temporary difference. Give rise to deferred tax, deductible temporary difference, deferred tax, asset. If it's taxable temporary difference, you will give rise to deferred tax, liability. Okay? TTD, taxable temporary difference, will be DTL. TTD will be DTL. DTD deductible will be DTA. Okay, right? So this one, try to familiarize. Okay, done. Thank you.